started off with our speaker this morning. I want to make a couple announcements. We're going to take summer off. We'll be having a summer vacation for the month of July and August. We'll again start in September, the first Friday in September, which will be, I think, September the 7th. And we'll go forward from there. And we have speakers lined up for September, October, and November already. So I'd like to know of any speakers that you would like to hear from. So if you just drop me a note on the back there of any topics that you'd like to talk here, I'd appreciate it. We'll get them lined up. And this morning, we have Mike Ivankovich, who will speak on house downsizing. Mike, I'll let you do the introduction and what you'll be talking about.
Thank you, Bill.
One quick question.
Yes.
You said it's the first Friday in September.
Yes.
At the 6th.
September the 6th, I'm sorry.
No, I'm looking at it because I just happened to turn to my party.
Yeah. Okay. Mike, good morning.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
And I thank you folks for coming out in this ugly, rainy morning. My name is Mike Ivankovich. I'm from Doylestown, about 5 minutes from here. I wear a lot of different hats. When I tell people I'm a home downsizing consultant, the usual response I get is I get a smile and I get a nod, and I can tell they have no idea what it is that I do. Then I tell them I'm an appraiser. I help people understand the value of what they own. I then tell them I'm an auctioneer. I help people convert the stuff that they no longer want into cash. And by then they usually start to get it. But then I take it a step further. I say, what I also do is I go out to my clients' homes and I do two things. I explain to them what their things are worth and how they can sell them for the most amount of money in today's market. And usual response I get then is, where were you several years ago when my mom got cheated, when my neighbor got taken advantage of? Well, that's basically what I do, and that's what I'm going to be talking about today. I'm going to basically focus on four things. I'm going to start off talking a little bit about the concept of value. Value is a little more complicated than many people think. Then I'm going to talk about 25 areas that are almost guaranteed to disappoint you when it comes time to sell things out of your house, because these are things we all have in our homes. Then quickly, I'll talk about 25 things you could throw away the minute you come home today, things we all have in our house. And then if we have time, I'm going to kind of wrap it up with a summary or an introduction of how you can sell gold and silver for the most amount of money without getting cheated. I'll try and show you how that process works. So, value is a more complicated subject than you think, because there are different kinds of value. There's insurance replacement cost value, that's here. There's fair market value, that's what the IRS wants to know when they're doing probate tax appraisals. There's retail value, what can you sell something for? There's wholesale value, what will somebody pay you for something because they still have to make a profit? There's liquidation value, that's the kind of value we see on TV if you watch Storage Wars and any of those other shows. What can I get for it today? There's book value, what does the book say that it's worth? There's the eBay value, the internet value, there's all different kinds of values. And most people think the value is just such a simple thing, you just go to a book and it tells you what it's worth. I deal in personal property, I have nothing to do with real estate. And the best definition of what I deal with is this: take your house, turn it upside down and shake it. What falls out is what I deal with. The good, the bad, the ugly. The antiques, collectibles, household contents, and the junk that goes along with it. If it doesn't fall out, the realtor is going to deal with it. So I deal with antiques and collectibles. Some of them are still hot today. Most categories aren't nearly as hot as they were 5-10 years ago. I help clients deal with their gold, silver, precious metals, coins, things like that. Collections. We've all collected things over the past 20-30 years. I collected Wallace Nutting pictures. That's my area of specialty. Other people collected other things. A lot of people just collected junk, but we all have some kind of collections that have to be dealt with. I help clients deal with firearms. I help clients deal with their vehicles. Sometimes they have various vehicles, not sure what to deal with. And then there's all that other stuff that just sits in the house that you're not sure what to do with, and they don't even want it at a garage sale. We've all got that kind of stuff too. If you're fortunate enough to have a house filled with high-end merchandise, you're fortunate. There's still a lot of demand for that. Rich people always have money. Rich people are always looking for the best of the best. And the high-end market hasn't taken nearly the hit that the middle market has. The market's changed. Things that we liked, our kids no longer want. things that we cherished and thought they would only go up in value. Our kids are looking at them as if they're dust collectors. They don't want the cut glass. They don't want the Nippon China. They don't want a lot of these other things. They want that 4G phone that will get them a phone call or download information 2 seconds faster than the previous generation. They want different things than we did. And then if your house is filled with low-end merchandise, that's not good, because it's going to probably cost you to get rid of it when it comes time to sell your home, because the value is usually in your home. When it comes time to downsize and sell your home, the value is in the real estate. The personal property has to be dealt with before A, the realtor can list it, and B, before they can close on it. You have to have all of that stuff out of there. So what's your stuff worth? Whenever I go out to a house, I ask three very basic questions right off the top. I say, are you looking for the most amount of money? Do you want to do the least amount of work? Or do you have to get rid of it in the shortest amount of time? Because how you answer that question is going to predicate its value. Let me explain where I'm coming from here. The worst position you could find yourself in is the shortest amount of time. I one time had a woman call me on a Thursday saying, Mike, I got to be out of my house on Saturday. What could we do? She left herself no options. It takes a good 6 months to a year to downsize a normal home. The usual response I get from people is, well, of course, Mike, I want the most amount of money. And then I say to them, well, if you want the most amount of money, you have to both be willing and able to do the most amount of work. Are you willing to have a garage sale? Not for 1 week, but maybe 5 or 6 or 7 weeks until it's all gone. Are you willing to polish what has to be polished, clean what has to be cleaned, repair what has to be repaired? Are you willing to pay to advertise it? Are you willing to sell on eBay or the internet what should be sold there? Are you willing to take it to the local flea market? Are you willing to put it on Craigslist and have people come knocking on your door? And usually when I get to that part, most people say to me, tell me about the option with the least amount of work. And the option with the least amount of work is either you send it to the auctioneer and you let the auctioneer deal with it, or you find somebody to buy it privately. But how you answer that question is going to determine how much money you can get for the things that you're selling. Let me throw three terms out: value, cost, price. Price, cost, value. At first blush, a lot of people initially think they mean the same thing, basically, but there's one very subtle difference. Price is a fact. If you were to go into an antique shop and see a cut glass bowl priced at $250, that price is a fact. You negotiate a price and you pay $175 for that. Your cost is $175. That's a fact. You get it home, what's its value? Value is a subjective number, and this is something really important for you to understand. Value changes day to day, situation to situation. So value is a subjective number. There's just not one single number for anything. Mike, how can the same thing have six different values? Well, it depends on how you're looking at it and what your perspective is. First of all, there's the book value. Book value is people think you could just go to a price guide and pick out a price, and that will tell you precisely what your thing is worth. That's not really true. And I know this from fact, because I've been writing price guides for 20 years. I write the National Wallace Nutting Picture Price Guide. And here's the dirty secret about price guides. The day the price guide comes out, prices are anywhere from 3 to 5 years old or more. Now, how can that be? Well, it takes the typical publisher about a year to publish a book. So if a book's going to come out January 1st, 2014, the author had to get it to the publisher January 1st, 2013. It takes the typical author about a year to write a book. So that means they started writing that price guide January 1st, 2012. But nobody starts a price guide without an accumulation of prices to base your book on. So most of those prices were dealt 2, 3, 4, 5 years or more earlier. Now, during the 80s and 90s, when antiques and collectibles were seeing prices go up, it didn't matter, because by the time the price guide came out, our things were worth more than the book said, so we were all happy. But since 9/11, prices on most categories are tumbling. And by the time a price guide comes out today, the prices are outdated. So book value doesn't mean a whole lot to me today. The content is usually there. If you're looking to date your home by the marking, that stuff doesn't change, but prices are constantly changing. There's your high retail value. Think about something in your house that you cherish. It might be a corner cupboard or something like that. And you say, if I got $5,000, I'd sell that today. If I don't get $5,000, I'm hanging on to it. Well, that's your high retail price. I call it a fishing price, because you're fishing to get top dollar. If you don't get it, you're going to hang on to it. But if you're looking for $5,000, somebody comes in and says, I'll give you $3,500 cash today, well, that's your quick sale price. Yeah, $3,500 cash today looks a lot better than $5,000 down the road. So that same thing can have a quick sale retail price. There's a wholesale value. Your $5,000 corner cupboard might be worth $5,000 on the open market, but if you're anticipating selling it to a dealer, that dealer has to make a profit. And that dealer has selling expenses, so they're going to pay you no more than a third to a half of what they think they could eventually get it for. If you want full retail price, you have to become a dealer. If you want to avoid that, if you want to do the least amount of work, you have to be willing to accept a wholesale price. There's the auction value. I call that the roll the dice number. You don't know what you're going to get at auction. Most auctions are sold at absolute auction, no minimum, no reserve. So someday you're going to get lucky, some days you're not. Part of what I do is I counsel clients saying, yes, this is a good thing to send to auction. You have a good chance of doing very well. Other things I tell my clients, don't send it to auction. I know it's not going to do well. But auction is the easiest way to sell things. The auctioneer does all the work for you in exchange for a commission. Then there's the liquidation value. What can I get for it tomorrow? That's kind of the storage wars kind of thing. You want to sell it very quickly, you need the cash for whatever reason. So that's how the same item can have six different values. So again, keep in mind, value is a subjective number. I'll give you a warning here, free appraisals. I see this all the time. People have their advertising, free appraisals, come in, come to our hotel, we're doing free appraisals today. There's no such thing as a free appraisal. What these people are doing is they are off making an offer to buy your things. An appraisal is an opinion of value put forth by someone who has no vested interest in buying something from you. These free appraisals, when you go to the hotels and these other places, these people are looking to buy your things as cheaply as possible and still make a profit on it. I'll give you an example. I did an antiques roadshow one time, and a couple brought in some sterling silver flatware. I told them I thought I could get them $1,200 to $1,400 for it. Well, they took it to a hotel, and I always say the worst place to take things to is a hotel, but they took it to a hotel anyway, and they were offered $400. And they said, well, we're not taking that. We thought it was worth, we know it's worth more than that. So they negotiated with the guy. They got $1,000 eventually. They could have gotten more elsewhere, but this guy initially offered them $400. Most people take that first offer. If you're looking to value your things, best place, the freest, cheapest place to go is eBay. eBay completed prices. eBay will tell you, you can find out on eBay what things have sold for within the last 2 weeks. That's all the data they give you. But eBay shows you what people literally have paid for something within the last 2 weeks. A woman one time called me, maybe several months ago, and she says, Mr. Ivankovich, I've got a Wallace Knight picture that's worth $425, and I'd like you to sell it for me. And I said, what's the title? She says, Comfort and the Cat. And I knew it wasn't worth that kind of money today. So I said, ma'am, where did you get that price? And she said, I read it in your book. And I said, what's the date of the book? And she said, 1986. So there's a perfect example of people thinking things only go up in value. But what a book said in 1986 is not necessarily valid today. So if you go to eBay, that shows you what people are actually paying. All right, let's talk about some things. I want to talk about the 25 categories that are almost guaranteed to disappoint you when it comes time to sell. These are things we pretty much all have or know somebody who has. Post-1970 baseball and sports cards. When I was a kid in the 50s and early 60s, there was only one baseball card manufacturer, that was Topps. What I did was, when I was a kid, I don't know, maybe some of you have done that. I used to take my baseball cards and put them on my bicycle with a clothespin, make it sound like a motorcycle. Whole generation of us did that. We destroyed our baseball cards. Baseball cards were my first personal foray into gambling. You know, playing flipsies and topsies and curbsies and all these other things. Our generation ruined our baseball cards. That's why cards from the 50s and earlier are so valuable. There's not many of them around today. But come the late 60s into 70s, 80s, 90s, there was a proliferation of baseball card manufacturing. There's 10, 12 different companies manufacturing cards today. Guys were going out and buying whole years worth of series of cards from an investment perspective, thinking that they would hold them for 10, 20 years and make a lot of money. But what they didn't realize was everyone else was doing the same thing. It was estimated that in the year 1989, there were 81 billion baseball cards printed. 81 billion. No market could absorb that today. So the price on later sports cards has dropped dramatically. Auctioneers are selling entire boxes, never opened, $2.50, $5 from the 80s and 90s because there's so many of them out there. So if you have the early cards, they still have good value. A Honus Wagner card from 1912 just sold for $2 million plus. So the early cards are worth money, but the later ones aren't. Collector plates. If you have collector plates in your home, enjoy them, but they're not going to provide you security in retirement. During the 80s, I used to buy my mom a B&G Yule After Christmas plate every year. Paid $30, $40, $50. Didn't matter. We always thought they were only going to go up in value. Kids don't want them today. They're dust collectors, according to the kids. Have you ever heard of a guy named Harry Rinker? Harry has a radio show called What You Got, and where people call him up and tell him what they got and what's it worth. One calls up Harry and says, Harry, I got a collection of collector plates. What do I do with them? Harry said, use them for target practice. They're cheaper than paper targets today. So if you have collector plates, enjoy them. They're not going to provide you a significant financial return. Almost anything with the name Mint in it, be wary. Franklin Mint, Danbury Mint. My pet peeve right now is the New York Mint. You'll see it on TV where they've just come across a new hoard of unfound silver dollars. And we guarantee these silver dollars are going to be graded between good and mint uncirculated, and they'll give it to you for $49.95, and you can't buy more than 5 or 10 of them. Anybody collect coins out there? Is there a New York Mint? No, there's no New York Mint. The U.S. Mints are in Philadelphia, Denver, and San Francisco. The New York Mint is a private company, but they make themselves sound as if they're part of the U.S. government. So be aware of anything with the name Mint in it. It's probably not going to bring you as much money as you thought. Department 56, Dick and Villages. A lot of people bought these for investment. I see them going to auction all the time. People send 20 of them, and they're bringing $5, $10, generally the most. They're not bringing a whole lot of money, so enjoy them. Post-1960s Christmas and holiday collectibles. I end up, usually for my clients, we donate them somewhere because they don't bring any money at auction. Those kind of collectibles mean a lot to your family because they're part of your family's memories, your holiday memories. But if the things to look for is if there's a barcode, if there's an area code, if there's a zip code, if it has a sticker from Two Guys, Kmart, Walmart, they're generally not going to bring a whole lot of money if you send them. People generally don't even want them at a garage sale. Now, if you have earlier holiday collectibles, very collectible, if you have some of those paper mache pumpkins from Halloween, if you have certain types of postcards from the early 1900s, those can have good value. Records, 33, 45, 78 records. Mike, I've got some records in my basement that are this thick. They're really good. They got to be worth a lot of money. Nobody wants them today. Those old records are usually things like John Philip Sousa. And how many people want to listen to John Philip Sousa today? The content is outdated. There are certain records that will bring you decent money. Some of the early 60s, late 60s, 33s have nice graphics. That's what people want more than the vinyl, is they want the graphics. But if you're not sure what your records are worth, go to eBay. It's the best place to go. I have go to the early, let's say you want to find out Sticky Fingers by the Rolling Stones. What's that album bring today? Go to eBay. You'll probably find 200 or 300 of them up there right now. So there's so many of these things out there, they don't bring that much money. I'm going to make a very brave and bold prediction today. 8-track tapes are never coming back. Almost every house I go in, there's cassette tapes in the basement, 8-tracks in the basement. People have been hanging on to them. They're not coming back. So donate them. You can try them at a garage sale. They probably won't sell. Once they don't sell, the auctioneer doesn't want them. So just donate them and take the tax write off on them.
Find any players, unless you have another car.
Yeah, I mean, that's basically it. Or you go to some kind of junk shop and you find the players. You're absolutely right. What they have been doing is they have come out with record players now that will convert your vinyl into a CD. You can get those at Costco and other places like that. Magazines from the 70s to today. Magazines, they're like baseball cards. They have been reproduced in such large numbers, they don't bring a whole lot of value. Playboy. Playboy came out in 1953, I think, with Marilyn Monroe. That issue is very rare because the first time anything comes out, they don't produce that many. It's only as something starts showing success and circulation increases that they start increasing the numbers. But Playboy has been the most kept magazine. Nobody ever threw those away. So you could have Playboys from the 50s that are bringing hardly anything on eBay because there's so many copies out there. Mad Magazine, if you have the first edition of Mad Magazine, it will be worth good money. But as Mad Magazine went along, production went into the millions of each issue, there's just not a whole lot of value in most magazines. Post-70s and 80s comic books. Again, similar to baseball cards. Comic book industry wasn't all that big when I was a kid in the 60s. And kids like me read their comic books from cover to cover over and over, and the condition isn't all that good. But first edition Superman, not long ago, sold for a couple million dollars. If you have the first edition, mint uncirculated condition. How many kids didn't read their comic books and rough them up a little bit? So there's not a whole lot of them there. What I look for with comic books is the price of the comic book. If the comic book is 50 cents, 75 cents, a dollar or more, they have nominal value. It's those comic books that are 10 cents, 7 cents, 5 cents, the earlier ones, they're going to have value because there's going to be a lot more rarity to them. Upright piano players. I'm not talking Steinways or Bostons or Baby Grands. I'm talking the uprights, the player pianos, and all the organs. They just bring no money. I had a client here in Doylestown maybe about a year ago, and she said, "Mike, I'm going to sell these things for $300 or $400 each." I said, "No, you're not." And she said, "Yes, I will." Well, about a week later, she came back. She says, "You're right. I haven't even gotten a phone call on these things." So, good news. I've had somebody who's agreed to come and take them away for $300. I says, no, we don't want to pay anybody. I said, what you want to do is put these things on FreeCycle. And you might want to write this down if you don't know what FreeCycle is. FreeCycle.com. It's take off a recycle, but it's FreeCycle. And you can't sell anything on a FreeCycle, but you can give things away and donate them. And it's zip code oriented. So if you put in 18902, there might be 5,000-6,000 members within our zip code. And, you know, within a couple of days, both of those things were gone. And they went to, like, a senior daycare center and a senior center. And she found a new home for them, and she didn't have to pay $300. But the bottom line is these big things take three people to move. There's no guarantee that the soundboard is working. They usually have to be tuned up. So the auctioneer really doesn't want them. And for you to pay to get it there, you're going to have to pay a premium fee to get something that heavy to the auctioneer. And if it doesn't sell for much, you're still going to pay a 25% commission. You're oftentimes better off trying to find a private buyer for it. JFK assassinated. Man landed on the moon's newspaper. You guys have any in your basement? Almost everybody in America does. We all save these things. And because of that, there's not a whole lot of value there because there's so many still in circulation. Limited edition anything. Generally don't bring a lot of money. Limited edition prints, limited edition collector plates, limited edition anything. The whole concept of limited editions were during the 60s that there's only one original of anything. But by reproducing a limited number of editions, people would buy them and they would be of investment grade. But the bottom line is most of these things have not risen in price as much as we might have liked. So if it's limited edition, be careful. And if it's got a certificate of authenticity with it, you're going to be disappointed because those certificates of authenticity were always issued to, in effect, enhance the value and make you feel more comfortable paying the price you were paying. Okay? But if it's got a certificate of authenticity, probably not going to bring nearly as much as you had hoped. New and contemporary dolls. The doll market is basically broken down into three categories. There's the antique collectible dolls. Those are your bisques, your French Bruges, your German bisques. That market's still pretty good. Those dolls bring pretty good money. Then there's the modern and collectible dolls. Those are the Annalise, the F&Bs, some of the dolls from the 40s, 50s, 60s. That market is okay. It's softened quite a bit. But what I'm talking about is these new and contemporary dolls, the things that were come out with boxes, and people want to buy 10, 20 of them, and put them in a closet saying, I'm going to wait 20 years and wait for the value to go up. Again, like baseball cards, the same thing. The value hasn't gone up on these things. They've gone down. If it's Barbie goes to Hollywood, Barbie and Ken go to Bermuda. I mean, those things came out in large quantities. They're generally not bringing a whole lot of money. Michael Jackson was an exception because after he passed away, the value of his dolls jumped up fairly dramatically for a short period of time. So timing means a lot with this. But by and large, those new dolls, mint and box, aren't going to bring you a whole lot of money. Auctioneers will generally sell them 4, 5, 6 to a lot. So if you got some of those tucked away, maybe you want to let the grandkids play with them. Most local contemporary art, and I'm not saying local here in Bucks County, I'm saying local anywhere. We've all been to places, restaurants, galleries, diners, coffee shops, where there's pieces of art all around the wall. And they're priced at $600, $800, $1,000, $1,200, and they're all gorgeous. And I'm not saying they're not worth it. But what I am suggesting is if you bought one of those pieces and paid $1,000 because you and your spouse liked it, it doesn't mean it's going to bring $1,000 today, unless that artist has become collectible, unless that artist is being sought after. Most important thing to keep in mind here is what you pay for something has no bearing on what you could sell it for. You could throw that concept out. It all depends on how interested other people are today, and generally means how interested the younger generation is today. Coins and stamps in fancy packaging. The fancier the packaging, the less the value. I'm not saying coins and stamps aren't valuable. We'll get to the other coins and stamps later on. But I'm talking about that stuff in fancy packaging. You know, you buy it on QVC for $49, $39. Here's what you generally get. When I was a kid, on the back of the comic book somewhere, you could buy 1,000 stamps for a penny. Okay, these were the common stamps that really didn't bring any money, and that's what these people have done. They've taken a very common stamp that was in good condition, and they would mount it, and they would tell you a wonderful story about the country of origin and all the people, and they give you a whole piece of literature, two sides, and it's slickly packaged, but the stamp inside is still worth pennies. So there's not a whole lot of resale value there. Same with the coins. You know, you sometimes see these packaging with coins. The coins you're getting are going to be common years, in less than acceptable condition, fairly well worn. So they just generally don't bring a whole lot of money. Use bedding and use linens. People don't want other people's linens. I mean, let me turn the tables on you. How comfortable would you feel going to an auction and bringing home some bedding and some other people's linens, not knowing where they've been? It just, these things don't bring much money. If you know somebody who can use things and they know that's coming out of your house, then you know the house is nice and clean. But when these things go into auction, they go into a big void, and people don't feel comfortable buying those kind of things at auction. Crafts. I love crafts. I love going to the Doylestown Craft Fair in town. That's 2 days in conjunction with the bicycle race or any of those others. And I don't have the talent that most of these crafters do. Their works are beautiful. But with that said, just because you pay $200 for something at a craft fair for something doesn't mean you're going to be able to resell it 5-10 years later for that same amount of money. Crafts generally don't hold their value. They're great decorative accessories. You've enjoyed it. They owe you nothing. But don't be surprised if you can't get close to what you originally paid for. Upholstered furniture. This market is really hurting right now. People don't feel comfortable going to auction and buying upholstered furniture not knowing where it's come from. They're afraid of the bed bugs. They're afraid of the cooties. They're afraid of what's going to come out of that. So I go into houses every day where there's nice, clean upholstered furniture, and I tell my clients, if you could sell it privately, sell it privately, because if you send it to auction, you're going to have to pay to get it there, and it's not going to bring you much money. If you know somebody who could use it, donate it. But upholstered things just don't bring much money at auction. Roll top desks. Mike, what do you mean my roll top desk is only worth $200? I paid $2,000 for it a few years ago. What's wrong with roll top desks?
Nobody uses them.
Why not?
They're not functional, not user friendly.
Exactly, they're technologically obsolete. You know, where do you put your computer and your printer and your monitor and your modem and all the other accessories that go along with the computer world today? So roll top desks are great to look at, and everyone likes them, but they don't bring much money when you send them into the open market. It takes three people to move them. If it's an original rope top desk, it's going to wobble because those things have, the glue has dried out over the years. So my advice to clients with roll top desks is try to sell them privately. If you send them through the auctioneer, you're going to pay the 25 to 35% commission, you're going to pay the moving fee, and you're probably not going to be satisfied with the price. Council TVs. But Mike, this TV's worked for 40 years. What do you mean it's not worth anything? The younger generation doesn't want these because they're not high def. If they break, where do you get tubes to fix them? My advice to clients is if you have a council TV that's working, use it. Use it till it breaks because there's no value to it in the open market. Same thing with non-flat screen TVs. The younger generation wants flat screen, high def TVs, and nothing else. I did a clean out a while ago, and they had four of those big, black, heavy Sony TVs, all in perfect working order. I tried to donate them to Habitat for Humanity. They wouldn't take them because they couldn't sell them. So I offered them up to the drivers, saying, guys, take them. They're free. We don't want them. We want flat screens. I ended up I had to throw them into the dumpsters because nobody wanted them. Yes, sir?
It's actually illegal to do that, throw them into a dumpster.
I was not in this state.
Well, it's because of what they include in the tube. Aside from that, Goodwill doesn't take them anymore, but Best Buy does. You have to take them there, and they'll take them, and they actually reclaim some of the goods that are in there that are reclaimable.
So you're saying for people who have TVs that they need to get rid of, Best Buy will take them for free.
Best Buy will take them.
Good advice.
Yeah, because we took one there. I know it.
Beautiful. Thank you very much. Entertainment centers. Mike, I paid $1,500 for that entertainment center 10 years ago. What do you mean it's worth $50? What's wrong with entertainment centers?
Outdated.
A little more.
Too much space.
They only fit 35-inch TVs. Most people have TVs that are 45, 55, 65 inches. Most of these have become outdated because you can't fit the TV in there. If you look at the new entertainment centers, if you go into any of the furniture stores, entertainment centers today are open-sided. They will accommodate any size TV. They have the flat back and the storage area underneath, but they're open-sided because now TVs are large. I've got a 55-inch TV, and my son has one that's like 68 or something like that. Our generation, fine. We would have taken something like this, and we would have converted it into a liquor cabinet, a linen press, a storage area. Younger generation doesn't do that. So these things aren't bringing much money at auction when you send them today. Country collectibles. Country just isn't as cool as it was 20 years ago. And I'm a member of the Bucks County Antique Dealers Association. I personally love country. I have a lot of country in my house. But the fact is, it's not bringing what it did. 20 years ago, people were buying rug beaters and wooden kitchen utensils and put them on their walls. Today, the younger generation doesn't care for that. I looked at an issue of Country Living magazine a while ago. It took me to page 123 before I saw a real antique. Everything in there was shabby chic or newer things. Every house has used exercise equipment. Nobody wants it. You haven't used it for years. Don't send it to the auctioneer, because if the auctioneer has it and can't sell it, they'll probably charge you a disposal fee. My advice is to try and give it away to someone. If you can't give it away, put it at the curb with a sign that says free, and hopefully someone will take it. And this is my biggest disappointment of all. Brown furniture. The furniture market is dead today. Dining room sets, oak, maple, cherry, mahogany, things that we've always loved, aren't bringing anything today. Certain auction companies are turning away furniture, except for the best of the best. If you go to my website, michaelivankovichappraisals.com, scroll halfway down, there's an article I published called The Nearly Extinct Formal Dining Room. Why the things in your dining room are worth less than you thought. And the thing is, our generation doesn't use the formal dining room as much as my parents did, and our kids hardly use it at all. Every house in America I go into has a dining room. In that dining room, somewhere there's a hutch or a buffet. Underneath in that hutch and buffet, there's an extra set of china, there's some platters, there's some silver plate, sometimes some sterling silver, there's placemats, there's candles, the same thing in every home. But the younger generation doesn't use a dining room, so there's no one buying that furniture today. They're even building houses today without dining rooms. At our house, we have the family coming over. Once a year, we might use the fine china and the sterling. Generally, we bring out the paper, the plastic, and that's the easiest way to do it. So as a result, round furniture is not doing well. I warn you, before you send it to the auctioneer, check it out. Check out your other options first, because it's just not doing much today. All right, that's the bad news. Let me give you the good news, because there are some hot categories today. Things are doing very, very well. I'm going to go in descending order, number six to number one. Militaria is doing real well. World War II, World War I. The farther back you go, generally, the more desirable it's going to be. If you have things tucked away from yourself or from your family somewhere, these things can do pretty well. Had a client not long ago. They had 21 World War II Italian war medals. And they were like in a little fishing case with those little compartments. There was all in one thing. We ended up selling them online for over $20,000, and almost all of them went back to Italy. So there's a good market for some of this stuff. I had a buddy who bought a Vietnam War era helmet that was painted, paid a couple bucks for it, got it home, slowly stripped off the paint, found out it was a very desirable helmet, ended up selling for $800. So Militaria can do very well. Anything that's auto-related, boy toys, guys like their cars. The market has changed a bit. The Model Ts, the Model As that used to be so popular have dropped dramatically in price. The guys in their 50s and 60s who are buying cars are generally buying the kind of cars that they used when they were kids, the muscle cars, the GTOs, things like that. You know, if you watch on TV, the Meekum auto auctions, the Barrett Jackson auto auctions, you see cars are going for huge amounts of money. But cars, car-related things, Petroleon, anything auto-related generally does pretty well with the guys. Jewelry market is hot. You know, the gold and silver market has been fluctuating a bit over the last couple months, but it's still not bad. I think gold is just shy of $1,400. Platinum's over $1,400. Silver's around $22, $23 an ounce. So as the price of gold and silver fluctuates, the price of the jewelry goes up and down. I had a client not long ago. I took a van full of stuff, big stuff out of the house. That whole van brought something like $1,200. I also took and scrapped for that client enough jewelry to fill the bottom of a little bowl. I mean, not even thick, just a little bit of jewelry. The jewelry brought $5,500 because it was gold, and we were able to get good money for it. So gold and silver is doing really well. Jewelry is doing really well. Number three, the high-end art market. Rich people have money, and people with a lot of money aren't interested in putting it into a CD that's going to earn them 1.5% interest a year, so they're looking for alternative investment means. And the high-end art market is doing real well for them. Now, unfortunately for me, I deal with wall-stunning pictures. That's the middle market of the art. And those things have dropped pretty dramatically, like a lot of other middle market art. But the high-end art, the best of the best, people are using high-end art as a good place to park their available currency. Number two, gold and silver coins. They're doing real well. Had a client a while ago. He had four binders of silver dollars. But not only did he have silver dollars, he had the right ears in the best of the best condition. Those four binders sold for almost $39,000. So there's good money in gold coins, gold, silver. All right, those are number six or number two. What do you think the hottest market out there is today? No guesses? You're not going to like it. Firearms. Firearms market is hot. You go to firearms auction, they're paying retail plus for things. They're recycling reloading equipment, ammunition, guns, handguns, vintage, hunting. There's a couple companies, Heritage down in Texas and Rock Island, I think, is out in Illinois. Those companies are doing gun auctions of $5, $10, $15 million. So the gun market is really hot. So if you have handguns, if you have rifles, it's a good time to sell them because the price is very good there. Am I okay time-wise, Bill?
Yes.
Okay.
Fine.
When you get home today, here's 25 things you can throw away. Magazines from the past 10 years. They're probably not going to go up in value. They're taking up space. You could probably just let those things go. You're not throwing anything of value away. All receipts you no longer need for taxes. If you don't have them, unless they're going to be used for the basis of your home, you'll probably let those things go as well. Bills that are more than 1 year old. If you haven't paid it, if they haven't come back, come after you, you're probably okay and you can let those things go. Bank statements you no longer need for taxes. 5-7 years is what accountants generally tell you should keep. You know, you don't need that stuff from 10, 15, 20 years ago. Probably not idea still, not a bad idea to shred it. But if it's taking up space, let it go. Keys without locks, locks without keys. Everybody's got those in the drawer, hoping to find the alternative. And to that, I would add combination locks without combinations. If you haven't found the combination in a couple years, you could probably throw that lock out too. Surplus twist ties. My rule of thumb is no house needs more than 1,000 of them. We all have drawers with those things filled with them. Containers of partially used cosmetics that you haven't used in the last 6 months or a year. If they're starting to harden, you could probably throw them out. Medicines for conditions you no longer have, let it go. Socks without mates. If you haven't found the mate in the last 6 months, you're probably not going to find it. Same thing with gloves. Everybody's got those kind of things in their closet. I know I've got some waiting to find the mate. I'll never find it. Single costume earrings. Now, I'm making a point here. If the costume earrings, you could probably throw them away, but be sure you're not throwing away gold or silver earrings, because even if there's one of them, you've got scrap value. They should be marked sterling or 925. They should be marked 10K, 14K, 18K, or something like that. Those things still have good scrap value, so make sure you're not throwing away any precious metals. Stale spices and cooking ingredients. If you haven't been able to reach into the back of that shelf in the last year, have you used those things in a while, you could probably let those things go. Overused pots and pans. Old Tupperware containers. I mean, I think we've probably got about 100 of those plastic Tupperware containers with lids. I'm not sure why we keep them, but we do. Dishes, cups, glasses that are chipped, cracked, damaged. Nobody's going to want them down the road. So there's no sense saving them for selling, because if they're singles or if they're damaged, no one's going to want them. Incomplete sets of glasses. When I'm doing a clean out of people's homes, if there's complete sets, I'll send them to auction. Complete being, you know, 6, 8, 10, 12. If there's one, two, or three of a set, we just donate them or throw them away, because there's not a whole lot of value there. Teacups without saucers, vice versa. You need them both to go together to have any kind of value at all. Plastic garden pots. My rule of thumb is you don't need more than 25 or 30, which we've got in our garage, but they're not going to bring you a whole lot of money. Paperback books without covers. I don't advocate throwing them away. I advocate donating them to a church, to a book sale, to friends, to the hospital, senior center. Let other people use them, but there's not going to be a whole lot of resale value. And if you think you're going to put out 200 paperbacks at a garage sale, you'll probably end up making a gross of $1 for all your work. Old college textbooks. When you were in college, you couldn't sell the textbooks to the students coming in the next year, because every year the professors changed the books. So textbooks from 10, 20, 30, 40 years ago have practically no value at all today. Wire clothes hangers. You're not going to sell them, so what I usually advocate is, instead of throw them away, take them back to the person, to the dry cleaners that you're using, donate them back. But the wire clothes hangers aren't going to bring anything. Dirty or soiled sheets, towels, pillows, they don't want those recycled. If they're really clean, the donation places will take them, but if they're damaged in any way, just throw them away or use them as rags. Soiled box springs and mattresses, nobody wants them. The auctioneer doesn't want them. And if you send them to the auctioneer and they don't sell, the auctioneer will charge you, in addition to a commission, a handling fee to dispose of them. Outdated technology, and I say 5 years or less. If you're still sitting on a 64 RAM computer hoping that's going to come back, it's not. And the parts of it are probably not going to do you much good as well. Partially paint cans 3 years older or more. Hopefully you've marked them, which room they were in, but after a couple of years, you're probably not going to be able to use that stuff. Do I have time to go into the gold and silver game real quick, guys? Okay. Gold and silver, let me throw out a question. How many penny weights are in a troy ounce? No hands raised. How many grams in a troy ounce? No hands raised. Well, you're not alone. Nobody understands this. And the minute you walk into a We Buy Gold place, the prices are listed in penny weights and grams. So you're behind the eight ball the minute you walk in. Here's a typical scenario. You're going to walk into a shop, and they're going to take what you have, and they're going to weigh it, and they'll convert it into penny weights or troy ounces or whatever. And they're going to determine the pure gold content or silver content. And I have a whole class I do on this, so I'm not going to go into all the details. But sterling silver, for example, has to be 92.5% pure silver, 7.5% base metal. If it's gold, 10, 14, 18 karat, it's going to be different percentages of gold in that piece. So first they have to figure out how much pure gold is there. Then they look at the spot price. What is gold or silver selling for today? There's a website called Kitco. You can get that. You hear quotes all the time on the radio. But the price of gold and silver changes as regularly as the stock market. Depends on what the buying and selling price is. And then they're going to calculate what you brought in is worth. So they're going to look at the gross weight, then the net weight of whatever metal you're giving them, what the current price is, and then they're going to look at what is the whole package worth. But no one is going to pay you full price because the dealer has to make a profit and the refinery that they sell to has to make a profit. So there's still people have to make profit in this thing. So no one is going to give you the full gross value. And this is where the smoke and mirrors comes in when it comes time to sell precious metals. And if you don't understand how the system works, it's very easy to get taken advantage of. The key thing here is what percentage of spot price is the buyer going to pay you? You know, 50% or less? 60, 70, 80? You're probably not going to find many that pay 80. You're probably not going to find anybody that pays 90. But that's the key thing. And no one knows to ask that question. What percentage of spot price do you pay? I'm going to give you an example here how the process works. You've got 100 ounces of pure silver, theoretically. And I did this back when the spot price of silver was $35. So 100 ounces of pure silver times $35 spot price, the silver value is $3,500. If someone is willing to pay 80%, you know, and they're going to work off a 20% profit factor, they'll pay you $2,800. But if you find someone who's only paying you 50%, you're only going to walk out of there with $1,750. So in that example, you've just lost $1,000 because you didn't know what questions to ask and you didn't know what the things weighed before you walked in. And that's in a nutshell, within less than 5 minutes, how that whole gold and silver process works. You're putting money into the dealer's pocket if you don't understand how the process works before you go in. So just a couple of key learning points. I'm going to wrap it up. You need to understand that different dealers pay different prices. We buy gold places all over the place. Some are reputable, some are not. They will all pay different prices, but everyone wants to pay you as little as they possibly can. That's just a fact of business. Nobody wants to overpay. Before you go in, know what you have. Know the weight. What's the amount of pure gold, pure silver that you actually are dealing with? Because if you don't know, how can you know whether or not you're being taken advantage of? Because everybody will tell you we pay more than anybody else in town. If you don't ask what percentage of spot price they're paying, they're not going to volunteer it. They're just going to give you a number. They're going to tell you, here's what we'll pay you for your things. And they're able to look you in the eye and make you an offer that they think you're willing to take. And it's going to be the lowest offer that they think you're willing to take. Shop around. Different places will pay different rates, depending on what you have. If you need help, call us. I mean, we do a lot of this. We specialize in helping clients convert their gold and silver into cash. We don't buy anything. We're appraisers. That's how we work as appraisers, but we make sure our clients don't get taken advantage of. Real quick, what I do. We go out to people's homes. Our fee is $195, and we basically do two things. We help them, A, understand the value of their personal property, and B, we help them understand where they could sell for the most amount of money. If we have to, we could do the whole thing. One of the beauties of my job is I wear a lot of hats. Wednesday night, I was in a tuxedo calling an auction, fundraising auction for American Diabetes down in Newark, Delaware. Yesterday, I was helping a client fill up a dumpster with stuff that they were cleaning out a house in the state from. Tonight, I'll be in a tux again over at Bucks County Community College calling their fundraising auction, and tomorrow I'll be back in the dumpster. So I wear lots of different hats, do lots of different things, but we can help people get the job done if they can't do it themselves. Again, we help people sell their precious metals. Perfect vignette. I had a client brought in a tub, just a Rubbermaid tub of things they got as wedding gifts 40 years ago. They didn't know what it was. So we sorted it into silver plate, pewter, sterling. I sent them home with the silver plate and the pewter because there wasn't a whole lot of value. But then we weighed up the silver. I said, here's what I think I could get for you. They said, go ahead and sell it. We signed a letter of agreement. And I ended up getting them $4,500 for the sterling silver that was in there. They didn't even know they had it, or they didn't know what it was worth. And what we do is we charge 10% of whatever check we give to our clients. We don't buy anything. We simply work as brokers. We do all kinds of personal property appraisers, from insurance, life planning, probate tax appraisals, anything like that. It just, what I found is, like, when people are downsizing, nobody wants an expensive written appraisal. People just generally want to know, give me a ballpark of what it is so I don't get cheated. And so we do a lot of those walkthrough appraisals as well. We're auction brokers. We help people find the right auctioneer for what they're selling. And that's the key thing when you're selling at auction. Auctioneers are different. You wouldn't take your divorce to a patent attorney, and you wouldn't take your patent work to a divorce attorney. Auctioneers the same way. Different auctioneers have different specialties. I am the best auctioneer in the country for Wallace Nutting, hand-colored photographs, early 20th century prints and pastels, etc. I'm not the right guy to sell your silver, your furniture, your china. Not because I can't talk fast, but because I don't have clients in my audience looking for it. And so the key for you to sell for the most amount of money is find an auctioneer specializing in what you got, who's got a preponderance of buyers there to buy it. As I said, I'm a fundraising auctioneer. I love raising money for good causes. I do lots of those. I love talking. If you have a group that needs a speaker, I got lots of different presentations. If you don't like me, I founded a group called the Bucksmont Speakers Bureau. Bill, you might want to look at this. There's a whole bunch of speakers there. Just go to BucksmontSpeakersBureau.com, find a speaker, contact them, book them, and they're all vetted. They're all good speakers. I'm the author of the book, Home Downsizing in 4 Easy Steps, and I'm available to answer any questions that you have.
Any questions?
Great job.
Thank you.
Mike, thank you very much.
Thank you. I could go on for hours.
One comment, when you mentioned sitting on old, outdated technology, remember, there's a lot of old cars around. I got one of them that's 30-some years old, and I almost drive it every day, and it's old, outdated technology, but I do know how to maintain it.
I stand corrected. I was referring in terms of computers and all, but yes.
I'm only pulling your chain. It's not all inclusive. It never is.
Hey, folks, thank you for coming out in this heavy rain. I appreciate it, and I'm appreciative of you coming out.
Mike, appreciate it. That's an excellent presentation.
Thank you.
And thanks again.
Thank you, Bill.
Thanks. We will see you all in September.
Right.
Okay?
Have a great summer.
Have a great summer and enjoy. Pardon?
See you in September.
September.